1 Corinthians chapter 1, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 17 and 18 is where our text is found today. A lot of the theme of the service today, and it's not been intentional necessarily, has been about the cross and been about the blood of Jesus. And today I want to talk to you about what I'm calling cross culture. Cross culture. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 17 through 18, it reads like this. For Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be made of none effect. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word. You've heard, if you've been paying attention to the news at all, about cancel culture. It's sort of the latest buzzword, and indeed it does seem like there is a lot of canceling that is going on in our society. A.P. Dillon states this, the phenomenon known as cancel culture has swept from state to state and country to country for a number of years now. Cancel culture is an aggressive form of public shaming where a person, group, company, or even a product is set upon by an internet mob for having committed some offense, usually one that is highly subjective in nature. There are examples of cancel culture. There was a church in Birmingham, Alabama, who was stripped of its lease agreement with the city, which allowed the congregation to use school property for Sunday services. The city decided to revoke the lease because Church of the Highlands pastor Chris Hodges liked conservative posts on Twitter. New Orleans Saints quarterback Drew Brees was forced into making not one but two apologies for saying he disagrees with those who choose to protest injustice by taking a knee during the national anthem ahead of games. He has repented for the pain his opinion has caused. Some are protesting the Splash Mountain ride at Disney World, saying it should be renamed and rethemed because it is somehow offensive. Several classic Dr. Seuss books have been pulled from the shelves. Our favorite syrup, Aunt Jemima, has been replaced with some bland and boring logo instead of the pleasant, smiling face that has greeted generations at breakfast. Mr. and Mrs. Potato Head have been made gender neutral because, I guess, a male and female plastic potato toy was really upsetting to some people. Cancel culture is real, and it's more like what I call mob morality. Whatever the mob decides is offensive at the moment is that which is offensive at the moment. If you disagree, you're labeled as a hater, a bigot, or some other term, which in itself is offensive, especially because it's inappropriately and inaccurately used in most cases. Now, can cancel culture occasionally get it right and address an issue that we may not be aware of? Sure, it may. That's possible because there's things that in our world do need addressed. But much of what the mob wants to cancel is things that are harmless or even good. It used to be in our world, and think about this, it used to be that people sinned in private and at least pretended to be moral and religious in public. Some of you probably remember a day when men would not swear in front of a woman, for example. There were certain sins in our society that were so rare and so unmentionable that when they occurred, the person committing them was an outcast in their community. And this sort of hush-hush whisper campaign began, but it certainly wasn't celebrated. Sin was committed in private, and people at least pretended to be moral in public. Now that has flipped entirely. Sin is paraded. Immorality is magnified. Wrong is worshiped. And evil is elevated. And if you dare to live a moral and religious life, you are to do so only in the confines of your own home. And that's becoming a maybe. Mark my words, and I'm not trying to preach doom and gloom this morning, but I believe the time will come when people will oppose you teaching religion to your own children in your own home. They will try to regulate what is preached at church or what is shared in the classroom at a private Christian school. They will do their best to silence our pulpits, our classrooms, and even our voice of influence within the four walls of our own houses. And here is where we stand. Everything that is good and decent, if you say, I love God, and I believe this means that you should live a moral life, I believe this means that you should adhere to the rules of God's word, you are to keep that to yourself. You are to keep quiet about that. You are to not share that, lest you would offend someone. But everything that is evil and perverted and wicked is to be paraded and promoted in public. And I believe that that is the goal of cancel culture, is to take what is good and put it away and promote what is bad so that the conscience can be silenced. It's almost as if the mob wants to be God, to decide what is right and wrong on the whim of the moment. And occasionally they may get it right, but many times they will get it wrong because it seems that there is a notable effort to push God and morality and people who believe in absolute truth, to push them off into a little corner where they have no voice. To those of us who know God, it makes no sense. We scratch our heads and we can't figure it out. And we ask ourselves, what is the answer? Well, it's Easter season. And I want to remind you on this beautiful Sunday morning that the fundamental answer to all of life's problems is always the same. What we do not need is a mob running around trying to cancel people who offend them. What we need is a culture of the cross. Now, I want to share with you what I mean by that today in these five brief points. First of all, at the cross, there is a confrontation. There's a confrontation. Billy Graham said that the cross offends because it confronts. Did you get that? The cross offends because it confronts. That confrontation is necessary for salvation. Now, most people don't like confrontation. People get angry at confrontation, and we think that confrontation is bad. But the cross is all about confronting people's sin. Now, we are used to nice, polished images of the cross. It has become a loved and treasured symbol. People display it in their homes. Some choose to wear it. We hang beautiful crosses in our churches. However, the cross was not always a symbol of love and beauty. It was not always revered and cherished. It was an instrument of death, as much as the gallows, the firing squad, the electric chair, or the lethal injection room. This cross meant death. It was a simple, crude, effective, and torturous means of exacting the highest price possible for crimes, death itself. While we would never display an electric chair in the front of our sanctuary or hang gallows out on our front lawn, we lovingly display the cross. Why? Because of the confrontation that happened there. On that old rugged cross was the confrontation of the ages. The God of all time faced death itself on that cross. He bore the weight of sin on that cross. He confronted death and hell on that cross. And while he hung there, he was mocked, sarcastically offered vinegar. He was jeered. You read about that in the crucifixion story. He was confronted. The cross has been a place of confrontation, and it has been so ever since. And when we bring the cross into our culture, into the world in which we're living, it says to them, something is wrong with how you're living. Friends, that is confrontational. If you want a confrontation, just tell somebody that they aren't doing something right. Nobody wants to hear that. And so the message of the cross is not always popular because it singles out sin. It sets up a showdown with Satan. It confronts culture where culture is wrong. And when the cross is brought into culture, it sets up this confrontation. It is different than cancel culture, where random things are decided to be right and wrong due to the whims of a woke mob of the moment. The cross confronts culture about that which grieves God. If we want to know where culture is wrong, we look at what God says and we contrast it with what people are doing, saying, or believing. And the cross says you're wrong. The cross says you're guilty, and that is a confrontation. But the cross is so much more than just a confrontation. Do you know that confrontation just for the sake of confrontation is chaotic? There are plenty of bomb throwers and gaslighters in our society, and they certainly aren't spiritual because they're confrontational. The cross does not just pick a fight for the sense of conflict, but the cross confronts culture for a purpose, and that's what we come to secondly. When we come to the cross, there's a confrontation, but secondly, there's contrition. Contrition. When confronted with my sin, I should be humbled and embarrassed by the man that I am if I'm living in sin. Contrition is such an essential component of this culture of the cross because it was deep contrition, absolute humility, a drastic stepping down that caused the cross to be possible in the first place. We're familiar with the scripture found in Philippians chapter 2 in verse 8 where it says, "And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross." And you think about that. The one who spoke and the earth was is the one who humbled himself to the lowest extent and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross, even the death of a common murderer. When we consider that God himself did just that, we recognize that humbling ourselves as we come to the cross is a necessary step in coming to a new life with Christ. In the invitational song, "Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior," there's a phrase that says, "Kneeling here in deep contrition, help my unbelief." Contrition is sincere remorse. It is the sinner saying, "I have been confronted by my sin, with my sin, and I am sorry for them." The cross confronts us. It leads us to the place of contrition. Also, number three, it not only confronts us, it leads us to a place of contrition, but it leads us to confession. Confession. Romans chapter 10 and verse 9 and 10 say that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. The cross leads us to a place of confrontation, of contrition, which should lead us to a place of confession. Someone just asked me recently, "Pastor, do people need to confess their sins to you?" And I said, "No, they don't. If they want to, if we're talking about something and they're talking about their life of sin and what they've done, certainly not inappropriate for them to do so. But it is not a necessary step in salvation to go to a priest or go to a pastor and confess your sins. You need not tell me your sins, but you had best confess them to Jesus. And when you confess with your mouth, you are owning what you've done and who you've been. Cancel culture always wants to cancel the other guy, but the cross culture wants to get you to report to God what you have done. Friends, this is an essential part of salvation. Oh God, I am a sinner. We need to stop pretending. If we're living in sin, if we're living a double life, we need to stop pretending and stop playing and confess. The cross leads to confession. The cross confronts us, it leads us to the place of contrition, confession, and fourthly, it does lead to a cancellation. Now, this isn't cancel culture in the sense of deciding that this random toy or game or thing is no longer acceptable in society. This is a different type of cancellation. 1 John chapter 1 and verse 9 says, "If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness." righteousness. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 21 says, "For he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him." On and on we could go today reading verses about how God forgives our sins, how he cancels the sin debt. Jesus would tell people when they would come to him, he would say something along the lines of, "Your sin be forgiven you. Go and sin no more." It's not just that he cancels our sin debt. It's not just that he forgets them, never to remember them again, but he changes us so that we no longer have to live in sin. Amen. Thank God for the work of the cross, which can cancel our sin. The cross leads us to a confrontation, to contrition, confession, cancellation, and fifthly and lastly this morning, to commitment. Luke chapter 9 and verse 23 says, "And he said to them all, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me." This is something that our culture rejects, commitment to something like the cross. But when we're committed to the cross and to Jesus Christ, it means that we're dedicated to our faith and not our feelings. It means that we are dedicated to the Savior and not ourself. It means that I'm angry at what God is angry at. It means I'm offended about that which makes God weep. It means that I will carry the cross daily, that I will defend the cross, I will advance the cross. What our world needs on this Sunday morning is not more cancel culture, but more cross culture, where there is a confrontation of sin, contrition by the sinner, confession of transgression, cancellation of the sin debt, and daily commitment to the cross of Christ. I can't see into your heart today. I can barely see into your windshields. And I recognize that in the parking lot today, and those watching online, there may be people who say, "You know what, Pastor, I've walked with God for years. I know what it is to be confronted by my sin. I remember that condemnation that I felt. It went against everything that I was. It hurt. What God told me and showed me, my heart, my soul, my deeds. But I humbled myself, and I came to him and I confessed what I had done. And he canceled my sin debt." I hope that's where you're living today. And if you're not, as we pray in just a moment, that's exactly what you can do right here. As you're watching online or you're sitting in the parking lot, you can come to Jesus Christ in deep contrition, in deep repentance and sorrow, and confess your sins and ask him to cancel your sin debt. But with that will come this requirement, where you fully commit yourself to the cross, where you fully give everything that is in you, and again, to the world, to our culture. I've talked about that a lot today. Our text that we read said, "To them that foolish, or to them that perish, it's foolishness. It doesn't make sense why you would live for God, why you would adhere to these rules." That's how they look at it. It's not how we look at it, but it's how they look at it. They don't understand it. But I've got to die to that. I can't help what other people understand and what other people don't understand. What I've got to understand is that I'm right with God. I've got to have the witness of the Spirit in my life. I've got to have, if there's sin in my life, it's got to be confronted. And I've got to kneel in contrition. I've got to confess. And I've got to have that canceled. And then God leads us to a place of commitment to him, when he asks for everything that we have, everything that we are. And he says, "If you want to serve me, you take up your cross daily." Daily. And serve him. If we want to change our culture, We're going to do so not by canceling Mr. Potato Head or any other thing like that. If we want to change our culture, our hearts have to be changed. And we have got to be willing to take the message of the cross wherever God leads. If you would, let's sing the little chorus that says, I'll take up my cross and follow Jesus. I'll take up my cross every day. I won't be ashamed to say that I love him. I'll count the cost, take up my cross and follow him. Let's sing it together. I'll take up my cross and follow Jesus. I'll take up my cross every day. I won't be ashamed to say that I love him. I'll count the cost, take up my cross, and follow him. Let's pray. Father in heaven, if there are those here today who do not know you, I pray that you would confront the sin in their lives. Bring them to a place where the old rugged cross and the work that was done there speaks to their life and says, you need help, you need me. Help them to come in a spirit of contrition, humbly repenting of their sin, confessing their sin. And Lord, I pray as you promised that you would cancel the sin debt. And then for every Christian, I pray that we would make that commitment to take up the cross daily and to serve you. It's in Jesus' name that we pray and ask all these things. And all God's people said, amen. Thank you so much for coming. Remember, if you're a first-time guest, please put on your four ways, or if you have a guest with you, and we have a gift for you out here at the end of the parking lot. There are offering buckets there. If you would like to contribute to the offering, you're welcome to do so. We invite you back next Sunday, and please come and bring people with you. God bless you, and have a great afternoon.